And welcome to the 10th meeting in 2022 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. The first item on our agenda is an evidence session on environmental fiscal measures for Scotland. The committee will hear from Callum Blackburn, independent consultant on the findings of research commissioned in session 5 by the Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform Committee, which has recently been completed. I welcome Mr Blackburn to the committee meeting. I understand, Mr Blackburn, you're going to present your findings for approximately 20 minutes and we will then open up to questions from members. Mr Blackburn.
Thanks very much, Convener, and thanks very much for inviting me along today. I'm going to read out one bit and the rest will be me a bit more free-flowing talking. So, in the previous parliamentary session, the Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform Committee was interested in the role of environmental fiscal measures, including taxes, levies and other charges as part of its financial scrutiny. The committee undertook some initial work to discuss the process of existing devolved measures and the potential priorities for further devolved fiscal measures in various areas of environment policy. The committee agreed to explore opportunities and risks of making use of new tax powers to change behaviour, and this research was commissioned to support that work. So that's a little bit of a background and introduction to it. I understand that you've got a kind of slide, a short slide pack. That's really just to keep me on track over the next 20 minutes. So I'll just talk to that. And the first thing is the overview slide. So what I'm going to cover in the next 20 minutes is the scope of the research, some overarching issues, could also call them strategic issues, some learning from 6 case studies. I'm not going to dive into all 6. I'm just going to pick a couple. But I realise there's some geopolitical events going on at the moment that might mean there's more questions around some of those that have become more interesting. And then the last thing I'm going to cover is a potential strategic approach, which is what the learning from the research, what can we do to kind of help shape our thinking for the future? And then lastly, some questions.
Sorry, I must interrupt you because I neglected to give the apologies of the Deputy Convener, Daniel Johnson, who is unable to be with us this morning. Because he has COVID and is quite unwell. So I do apologise to everyone for that and for interrupting you, Mr Blackburn, but I want to get on that on the record. Thanks.
No problem, Convener. So without further ado, I'll go on to the scope slide, really just to set out some thinking about the issues of the research report and how it's framed. So the first bullet point there, if you've got the slides in front of you, is ecological restoration and net zero aim. And they, I suppose in terms of looking at environmental fiscal measures, the first thing is what are you trying to do? And the strategic aim here has really been to look at the two major crises we have in terms of ecological restoration and net zero aim. So in other words, we've got a biodiversity crisis and we also have a climate change crisis. And so the aim is really what measures would help address those. The second bullet point is fiscal measures considered, and in brackets, carrot and stick. And I think one of the things in the previous sessions that was carried out that I just mentioned by the Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform Committee, it was kind of primarily looking at the stick. So looking at charges and taxes. In this case, I started with a sort of broader funnel because I looked at the kind of broadest definition of what a fiscal measure is, which is really an instrument that makes a flow of money happen. So we looked at both carrot and stick. So that means grants and subsidies as well as taxes and charges, because both of them will be able to influence the outcomes towards addressing both emergencies. And you could actually argue that you know, there's ample evidence that people respond to even small charges, and so there's ample evidence that people respond to fiscal measures in general. But you could actually say as well as that the fact that we've got these two crises is probably reflective that the cost, the real costs and charges in the markets are not correct and things aren't priced properly, and therefore we end up with environmental damage. So in a way, fiscal measures are a way of correcting that, balancing that out. So the next bullet point is filtered for relevance. And I just wanted to point out here that this is not a scientific process. Try to pick out things, that areas, particularly in the 6 case studies that are in the report, that are relevant to where parliamentary committees and the parliament itself will be looking in the next term. So a little bit of focus on things that are in the programme for government and the climate change plan update, and also things that are, you know, pressing in terms of key challenges around the environment. and then also considering what the European Union is doing and the kind of policy alignment to that. Drawing on particular areas of evidence of market failure and anything that is kind of particularly relevant for a Scottish context, which is actually quite subjective, but given the devolved nature of the Parliament, you know, there's things that are probably of more interest in certain areas where we actually have a sort of oversight rather than on a UK basis. And then the last thing, bullet point there, is the measures in development are under consideration. So I was aware there's a lot of things in the pipeline, so I've tried to bring that into the report as well, because they're likely to crop up in front of the committee or in the wider Parliament. So then moving on to the overarching issue slide, and I think here we're looking at things that are, what are really the strategic points that came out of the work? And the first thing I would say is the complexity of the current fiscal measures that we have. I mean, in Scotland we have air passenger duty, although it's not yet applied. We have landfill tax, we have single-use carrier bag charge, we have aggregates tax in the pipeline. We have energy efficiency grants, fishery, sustainable fishery payments, forestry grants, agricultural subsidies, and business innovation grants around things like circular economy. So it's a very complex landscape. And then you add on top of that the UK measures, which are fuel duty, renewable heat incentive, climate change levy, emissions trading schemes, contracts for difference for renewable energy, and even variable VAT charges. And that's an interesting one, because a mainstream tax like VAT can suddenly become an environmental fiscal measure if it differentiates between different products. So what you would say is that all of those things are probably doing some very good stuff, but if you were to look at it, I would assume that you'd probably find that they're all pricing things at different rates, and whether it's biodiversity loss or climate change. So I think one of the key things is to try and get to something that's a bit more consistent in all these measures, so that people have got clear signals as to what the real cost of things are. I think what we have is a very complex arrangement, which probably mimics what is often referenced by others, a very complex UK tax code, one of the most complicated in the world. So we do have that very a lot of complexity. The next point is on carbon tax and emissions trading schemes on the slide, and making a sort of Lord of the Rings reference. If we were looking for one tax to rule them all, it would be the carbon tax, and that's basically what a lot of external commentators would like to see happen. And there's a clear reason for that, because if there was a consistent carbon tax applied across all these measures, businesses and individuals would be able to make really good decisions. They'd be able to make a decision of clear transparency in terms of, well, what's the cost for a flight or a train journey or a car journey, and the carbon impact and other impacts should be reflected in any taxation charged on those. But that's really a decision for the UK Parliament, and there doesn't seem to be any movement towards that, because Scotland itself, I don't think, has the powers to introduce a carbon tax. What the UK government and the EU are moving towards, though, is something that's a proxy for the carbon tax, which is the emission trading scheme. So we have the EU and the UK emissions trading scheme. And what I'd like to point out here, I suppose, is you know, there is a great doubt as to whether that will actually succeed using trading schemes. They're very complicated. There's lots of loopholes. There's lots of areas of debate and choosing things that might not be right. So it's not got the transparency or the, I suppose, desirability of the carbon tax from a clarity point of view. And there's risks that it won't deliver, I suppose, in the long run. And I just wanted to point out that Scotland did have a trading scheme in the past. We had a landfill allowance trading scheme, which was actually around for a few years and then removed. So we have got a little bit of track history in that already. But given that we're not likely to get a carbon tax, I think the key thing for Scotland is that we need to work with the UK ETS and make it work as good as possible, so the UK emission trading scheme. And we need to try and maybe get some consistency in the measures that Scotland has some control over, so that we are giving clear messages. The next bullet point is the whole government approach, and I have to admit here that actually what I'm referencing here is something that's out of scope for the study, but I feel like it really have to mention it. So the whole government approach is something that has come from a coalition of finance ministers for climate action, and which includes the UK and 64 other countries. So what they're saying there is that if we actually looked at consistency of application of trying to get these strategic aims of net zero and ecological restoration, then we should be looking at all government expenditure. So that includes maybe the £12 billion of public procurement here in Scotland, and then the other revenue expenditure we have in other grants. And I know that already in the agreement between the current government, that there is plans to look at that for large grants. But I suppose the move to go further than that could be extremely beneficial, go beyond even the changes you could do with fiscal measures because of the sheer amount of spend of government. But it's a huge task because it would require enormous capacity building within government around finance and understanding climate change and biodiversity issues. So that is, it's not an easy thing to do, but the benefits could be huge. So that's me mentioning something that's out of scope. I feel I had to say that. Back to sort of the rest of the study. Repurposing existing measures is the next bullet point. And I wanted to highlight the urgency we have here. We have targets to meet by 2030, ambitious carbon targets. I'm not sure what targets will come out regarding biodiversity in the next year or two. But what that means is that really we're looking at two things, using all the existing technologies we have to achieve those targets, and maybe using fiscal measures to help support things that are currently niche but really need to be mainstream. So that's where some of the grants and subsidies come in. But the urgency suggests that actually we really need to focus on repurposing existing measures. So later on, I'm going to talk about agriculture, which is an example where we're kind of in the moment reviewing agricultural subsidies. But when you look at the timescales to introduce new measures and the engagement required with stakeholders, it is really quite challenging. And so it may be easier to just revisit existing measures and make sure they're really aligned to where we want to get to. The next point is increasing percentage of overall tax take. Within the report, we highlight that if we really want to succeed at this, and fiscal measures, environmental fiscal measures need to be a bigger part of the overall tax take. So if you had the same amount of tax collected in the economy, we probably need to see a shift from labour and employment taxes to things that are on resources and resource use. And that's challenging. At the moment, I think it's a relatively small percentage, maybe 6 or 7% in many countries, which are actually resource taxes. But if we're really going to have an impact then with the fiscal measures, then we probably need to make like a bigger chunk of the overall tax taken out of the economy, keeping it neutral level, of course. But if we do that, there are other challenges. It's going to be a much less stable tax base. So employment taxes are very stable. It's very beneficial to reduce employment taxes and maybe switch them to resource use from an employment, encouraging employment point of view. But then your tax base becomes less stable because people can take measures to avoid those taxes. The last point on that slide is local taxes and charges. And when you look through the case studies, you'll see that this I see as a major area of opportunity. It's very politically challenging to give more powers to local authorities, I understand that, but given that the Parliament's constrained by things like the UK Markets Act and the forthcoming subsidies bill, it could be that some of these local taxes and charges offer some real opportunity to support the aims towards the targets. So you'll see that if you have time to look through the case studies, you'll see there's quite a few points coming out there in terms of local taxes and charges. Okay. Enough of the strategic points then. I'm now onto the case study slide, and I've listed all six case studies there, but I really wanted to highlight two, waste management and land management. I realise given the current situation, there might be more questions on energy, so I'm happy to take questions on energy, but I feel that those two, given the parliamentary session and what is coming up, are worth diving into quickly. So on waste management, the case study looks at two measures in particular, and it's referencing the fact that we have an energy from waste review, a likely consultation on a route map to meet the waste targets, and a circular economy bill all in the pipeline. And the first measure really is about the fact that we're having to deal with the consequence of the success of the landfill tax. So the landfill tax has been really successful at pushing material out of landfill and into recycling. But now we've got the situation where energy from waste, now that landfill is becoming so expensive, is a more attractive option. But also we're finding from a technical perspective that energy from waste actually might create more emissions than landfill going forward. And the reason for that is basically we've got very good at extracting the food waste and the paper and the card out of that residual waste stream. And so it's now mainly plastics and fossil fuels. So it's equivalent to quite a strong sort of energy emission that we would get from more fossil fuel-based, like gas stations, etc. So there is an issue there that we need to address, and I'm sure that will come up in the review going forward. But there are a few other countries that have already introduced an energy from waste tax in the Netherlands and in Flanders. And I think this is something that we will probably have to do to prevent all the material just moving from landfill to energy from waste. There are other measures, though. If the Scottish Parliament doesn't want to go down that route, there are other ways of trying to change that, and I've highlighted those in the report. The second point under waste management is recycling systems. And one of the issues here is that all our recycling systems that we've rolled out over the years to households, they're all based on goodwill. In practical terms, a local authority has very little powers to actually make you comply with that system. And the end product of that is we find that, you know, 50 to 60% of the material that's in landfill bins, if you like, at household level, is actually recyclable or compostable. And so at the moment, it's really about awareness and goodwill. But what's happened is local authorities are obviously struggling financially. And the only thing they can charge for in that waste system is the green waste collection due to previous legislation. So what we're now having now is either local authorities removing compostable green waste collections or charging householders for them. And so now we're getting a distortion, almost like a negative distortion in the market, because we're charging for something that's beneficial and not charging for something, the landfill bin, that is not beneficial. So in this case study, I've looked at countries like Germany and Belgium, where they've introduced direct variable charging. So they put a proportion of what is currently collected in council tax as a charge onto the recycling and waste collection, and it allows them to incentivise people to put things in the recycling bins rather than in the landfill bin. And that seems like a very a sensible thing to do to help councils invest as well. But it isn't without challenge, political challenge in terms of changing that from council tax to a charging system. So those are the two things I wanted to highlight into waste management. And then the last one I wanted to look at was land management. Again, a very strong pipeline coming up in the Parliament in terms of the work to change the current subsidy regime. There's a biodiversity strategy and National Environment Act planned, as far as I'm aware, as well. So I really wanted to highlight here, the main challenge here is that we are, in terms of agricultural, we're going to have to make agriculture a lot more environmentally friendly from a wildlife perspective, and also a lot of agricultural land is going to have to be used to meet our forestry targets. And there's a couple of examples I've highlighted here from Sweden and Costa Rica, who have both been very successful in trying to change the way land management subsidies work to a positive way. So, for example, in Sweden, there's payments made for wolverine and lynx on land that is being managed by people, in a recognition that those predators are going to cause damage. But rather than pay for the damage caused, they actually pay for the amount of predators on the land. So changing that relationship in terms of a positive thing. Similarly, we have many countries now moving to sort of camera trap technology. So if you get like a predator or a beaver or something that's potentially not good for the farmer or the landowner, if it's witnessed in a camera trap, they get a payment every time that happens. So it's like positively encouraging them. You've got this thing on your land. It's really beneficial to us all, and we want to make sure you're paid for it. So moving away from a compensation culture. And I think that's going to be important moving forward if we're going to increase the biodiversity across what is a huge amount of agricultural land in Scotland. The second thing is the ecosystem service payments that they have in Costa Rica. Costa Rica has been fantastically successful at restoring lost forest, and it recently won the Earthshot Prize for that. And what they've done is moved to payments that are based on ecosystem services. So forestry, recognising the carbon impact of the forestry, recognising the wildlife benefit, recognising the flood management benefit of forestry and other land management techniques. And I think that sort of thing has to be incorporated, I suppose, within the new subsidy regime. I think if we're going to be successful at, getting more forestry in the land and, again, seeing the benefits of actually some of this wildlife that we have. The last point I was going to make here was there is an interesting local tax option that I've covered, which is a proposal from the John Muir Trust, which is looking at a natural carbon land tax. And the reason why I mention this is because it's something that could be done at a local level, perhaps through incorporation into business rates or something similar. It's meant to be a neutral tax. So basically the idea is that people who have land that's producing a lot of carbon would compensate those who are not producing very much carbon on their land. So it's kind of like, if you can imagine, an energy efficiency label system that they have when you go and buy an appliance, you get an A to G rating, and the money would flow from the G raters to the A raters. So there's no overall increase in the tax take. So it's an interesting proposal, but I think it's something that's worth considering within the subsidy review at the moment. And the reason why I say that is because people historically always respond to a charge much more strongly than a subsidy. The subsidies are significant in the agricultural sector and they can change behaviour, but also a charge can do the same. Okay, last slide, and am I okay for time, convener, or am I taking up too much time?
No.
Okay, fine. Okay. The last slide here is I've sort of taken all the data for a potential strategic approach from the research work and put it into what is a sort of simplistic model with fiscal measures that I think are the most relevant ones. Some principles we'd apply, some of those come from general taxation principles and principles around grants, etc., but also some that are tailored to the environmental aspect, and then some constraints that we have to consider. This is something really as a starter for 10 in university challenge language. So it's really trying to, I think this kind of area is in its infancy around the world, and I'm sure there'll be lots of things developing across countries and in the EU over time. But this is really trying to get us to think in a way about how we can apply measures in the future. I'm just going to touch on quickly on three aspects. Under the fiscal measures listed there, there's carbon pricing mechanisms, and I haven't mentioned that. But within government, there's a carbon price put in projects, and it's used within decision making. And I think that's a key thing that the Scottish Government has the potential to change, and it might influence some changes in, you know, which project options are selected over others. There's a strong argument in saying that carbon prices at the moment in these things are too low. The second point I wanted to make was on the principles. There's a bullet point there that's route mapped. I think it's really important for anything that's done now that there's a clear plan for the future, because we have such a short time frame. People need to be able to invest. I think the landfill tax was a really good example of that. We had an escalator that everyone could see where it was going over the next 5-10 years, so they knew what they had to do. And I think that is going to be really important for any environmental fiscal measures. And the last point I wanted to make was on constraints. Under there, we have UK solutions as a bullet point. And effectively, there's lots of things in the pipeline where I think Scotland's going to have to work with the rest of the countries in the UK. And the key lesson here, I think, is to get in early and shape it as much as possible for Scotland. The evidence from some of the producer responsibility schemes that we have is that often they're tailored to population centres in the south of England. So I think getting in there early when we're working on a UK solution is going to be important to get something right for Scotland. So that's me, and I'm happy to answer questions. I hope that made sense, and it was a bit of a fly-through of a very complex subject.
No, I thought that was excellent, really fascinating stuff, actually, Cam, so thank you very much for that, and I think it's probably generated quite a lot of questions from members of the committee and stimulated all our thinking in terms of this. I mean, I'm going to open with some questions, then we're going to go around the table, of course, so... I'll start off with your last slide, actually, in terms of fiscal measures, because you talked about carbon pricing mechanisms, route mapped and UK solutions. So I'm going to just mention devolved taxes and subsidies. I mean, I think it's really important that we take people with us on this journey, and I think that's going to be one of the most difficult things, ensuring that, as you say in your second principle, that things are proportionate, because what we have to ensure is that that you said yourself, behavioural change, goodwill you talked about from the public, we need to be able to do that. And I think it's about how we really kind of marry those together, you know, in terms of... So do you believe that, I mean, you talked about, for example, in terms of, you know, landfill taxes, how everything was kind of set out over a number of years so that people could see the kind of road to be travelled. Do you think that that's what the Scottish Government should try and do so that we have a kind of 10-year programme involving the kind of all the kind of issues that you have mentioned about how we kind of reach various milestones along the way and where we think... Where we think that changes should be made and at what time they should be made and by whom?
Yes, I think that's... I do believe that, and I know it's really challenging for government and parliament to achieve that, because there's always changes in things, and of course we don't know. You know, we've just seen the recent events in the last month or so. Things can change very rapidly out there. But I would give one example. Going back to the case study on waste management, we have a situation where local authorities are sitting there and other waste management companies, and at the moment it's quite difficult for them to invest because there's so many things that decisions they're waiting on. So we have deposit return scheme coming in, but we also have a number of reviews of producer responsibility schemes, which are basically a regulation with a fiscal measure attached. And those have been under review for a while, and you know, if you talk to a local authority manager in the waste area, they're like, I don't know where to put the money, I don't know where to invest, because I'm not quite sure what this is going to do. So I think that's an example of creating some certainty, and we've got very short timescales for these targets. So I do believe as route mapped as possible is really important, if that answers the question.
Yeah, I mean, I think it can be quite frustrating waiting for these decisions to be made. But if you're looking at something which is cross-cutting, involving a host of government departments, some team ministers, like consultation, etc., and trying to make sure that we don't end up, you know, with unintended consequences, some people being very heavily penalised, such that they could go out of business, for example, and whereas other people perhaps making a killing out of it, you know, to try to get this balance, I suppose it's understandable that would be the case, providing we get the 10-year programme or whatever it would be right, although there would have to be checks and balances in that, because no doubt decisions will be made which will prove to be wrong in terms of delivery, because nothing ever works as one would hope. But in terms of constraints, you talked about UK solutions. So, I mean, you mentioned obviously the importance of working with the UK, and I think everyone would agree that's absolutely essential in terms of this huge issue. But obviously, we can't always move at the pace of the slowest caravan. So do you think that the Scottish Government should look at things on two levels? One, what we can deliver as a Scottish Parliament, Scottish Government, in one kind of sphere, if you like, and then another where we can deliver with the cooperation of the UK. Is it possible? Do you feel that that can be done in a kind of parallel track?
I think it can. I mean, obviously, the Scottish Government and Parliament would be subject to things that they might not be aware of that the UK Government suddenly brings up. But I think, I think there is a parallel track there. I think the challenge is... coming back to sort of repurposing, like I mentioned, repurposing existing measures is going to be easier because, from a Scottish perspective, so the things we already have, than bringing in something new, because, and it might be, you know, in terms of the timing of this report, there's a lot of things that are kind of a little bit unknown. The UK Markets Act's not really tested. The common frameworks are not really tested. We've got a subsidies bill coming. So in some ways, the timing of this is that some of the things aren't very clear. But it does look like it's going to be quite challenging to introduce new individual things in a Scottish context because there's so many things to be tested at a UK level. So I think maybe, yeah, a parallel, looking at the whole thing and then seeing where you're going to work on a UK basis or where it makes sense to work on a UK basis and where the Scotland needs to do something itself. One of the last point I suppose I would make is that there is that trade-off between ambition and practicality and pragmatism, because often you might see Scotland's ambition on something and the environment being stronger than the UK and wanting to push ahead with something. And then you see the UK is actually going to do it, but maybe not as ambitiously. And then you have to say, well, from a resource point of view and all the resources required to make this happen, and I'm thinking here internal in government, you know, civil service agencies, etc., doesn't make sense to say, well, we just have to be slightly less ambitious here and more ambitious somewhere else and accept that we can work. This is actually going to be a more pragmatic solution. And that's obviously a decision the Scottish Government, Scottish Parliament is going to have to make. But that's kind of a bit of the trade-off. But I do think, going back to the original point, in the old round, it's good to look at the two parallel areas.
Thank you. And I mean, in terms of, you talked about an overarching issue, you talked about the complexity of current fiscal measures, and I think it's important that we ensure that the winners and losers don't win by too much or lose by too much again if we're going to take people with us. So sometimes that can slow down perhaps the pace of change, I would think. I know that John's quite keen to talk about carbon tax. I'm not going to touch on that. But in terms of increasing percentage of overall tax take, do you feel that you're shifting resources into more net zero solutions, do you believe that this could only happen with increasing the amount of tax revenue that's available, or do you feel that it can be done within the kind of current envelope, broadly speaking? Because obviously, if you look at one area of expenditure, which is the largest NHS, you might think, well, how do we actually make that more net zero without effectively shifting money from patient care to insulating buildings, whatever it happens to be? Okay, you could have long-term savings, but in the short term, you've still got to invest. So how do you feel in a practical, pragmatic sense that can be done? Or do you feel it's inevitable that the amount of money that government's going to have to spend overall will have to increase?
Well, in the report, I've made the assumption that it's kind of revenue neutral. So overall, the tax take wouldn't increase, and I think I suppose that's an assumption. That is an assumption. You could assume that the tax take was going to increase, but given what we've just been through with a pandemic, etc., that seems unlikely if we're to support businesses and people. So I've assumed that it would be a neutral thing. So in that case, we've got some examples. Excuse me, I think the climate change levy is one where there's a levy, but then there's also a compensatory mechanism related to national insurance to kind of offset that levy. So you could look at a situation where you've got something that, you put that resource tax on something, but then you reduce the tax somewhere else that kind of matches in a compensatory term. So that would be the way I would see it working. I'm hoping that there isn't a need to increase the tax take. I would prefer that, you know, we stimulate investment by others rather than the government having to find all that investment. I think particularly one area in the land management, obviously we have a lot of discussion around forestry and the fact that putting money into the forestry by the Scottish Government to meet targets is very important, but there's also a lot of private investment there looking for, in the short term anyway, carbon offsets for things that they can't actually address with renewable energy just yet. So you could see where you could pull in a lot of investment, which is not public money. So I'm kind of hoping that there wouldn't be a need to raise the overall tax envelope, if that makes sense.
Now, even if there was to be an overall increase in tax take, there's still a potential for significant costs to be imposed on the public through, you know, laws, regulations, whatever you want to call it. So, for example, renewable heat being installed in people's houses, you know, that we've been told that could cost up to £33 billion over the next 8 years, which is a colossal amount of money per house. And the money available for that's about £1.8 billion. So how do we encourage people, even assuming we had the heating engineers to deliver this in the 8 years, which I'm somewhat dubious about, but how could we actually, how can we deliver some of these very kind of admirable kind of ideas with the in practical terms, both financially and indeed in terms of the people who are able on the ground to deliver them?
Thanks. I think renewable heat is a challenging one because there's so many things. It's not just a fiscal measure that's the issue here, because there's a huge, if for people to introduce, say, a heat pumps, air source heat pump into their house and replace oil or gas boilers, is a major intervention in their property. Often you have to put in retrofit insulation measures. It's a change in how the system operates. And as you point out, do we have the skills and the heating engineers, etc. So there's an issue there that goes beyond the fiscal measures. But I think in terms of the renewable heat, the key thing is, from a revenue perspective, you've got to make it sort of stack up if you want uptake. So if you look at the situation with air source heat pumps, they produce 3 kilowatt hours of energy from 1 kilowatt of electricity, for example. So what you really need to have is a situation where, taking that into account, it's cheaper than oil and mainstream gas. And that's what we see in Europe, where there's a kind of 1-to-3 ratio. So your electricity might be 3 times as expensive as your gas, but because you're getting 3 times the amount of energy out of the heat pump, then the magnifying effect, and then effectively it might make sense for householders to move over to it. Here we've got a situation where the gap between the gas and electricity prices is just too high at the moment, and obviously the situation, geopolitical situation, has just made that worse in recent months. So there is an issue about, I think, ensuring we do everything, and this is probably, you know, a lot of these powers are at the UK Parliament level, but we do everything to make sure that the gap between electricity price, and which is the low carbon option, and the fossil fuel price used for heating is reduced to the level where these heat pump technologies make sense. And then, you know, from a householder perspective or a business perspective, you're going to look at it and go, well, if I put this technology in, there's an initial cost, yes, there's disturbance, but I know over the next 10 years it's going to be cheaper. So I think that's going to be a key issue to try and make it happen, because obviously the amount of people putting those systems in their houses at the moment is way below what we need. So I think that's one of the key factors. The other thing, last thing I would touch upon, is not to underestimate the expert advice and technical support that householders and businesses need. And that's where somewhere like Energy Savings Trust or other services become really important to help them do that. So it's a complicated area. Fiscal measure is one part of it, but there's a lot of other bits that go with that, if that makes sense.
Okay, thank you. Now, you mentioned in your presentation countries ranging from Belgium, Sweden and Germany to Costa Rica, and some of the excellent work that's been done in some of these countries. Do you feel that the Scottish and indeed UK government, you know, should, you know, look at actually what's happening in these countries in greater detail and try and implement, you know, some of the measures that they're doing here rather than try and reinvent the wheel and come up with something new which may or may not work? Adapting successful measures elsewhere, I think, could save a lot of time and a lot of effort if that can be done.
Yeah, and I think I would agree. I think that's really important because it comes back to this thing about that I mentioned about the urgency. And so trying to invent something new could be quite challenging in the timescale to meet these targets that we have, you know, in coming up in less than 10 years. So, yes, I think... And I know, for example, that when the deposit return scheme, was being designed. There was a lot of work there looking at all the countries that have already been running one for decades. And so you could take that principle and apply it to a lot of these things, trying to learn from others. So I would agree with that.
Human scientific ingenuity shouldn't be ruled out. So in my constituency, there's a company called DSM, employ around 350 people, and they have developed a feed additive called Bovar, which will reduce the amount of methane emissions from cattle from between 30 and 90%, depending on the what type of cattle they are, whether they're dairy, beef, and what their food, their feed is. And that would cost much less than, for example, retrofitting huge numbers of houses, and could have quite a significant impact on the environment itself. So there are a number of other areas that we can actually look at them. And there's going to be a £100 million plus investment in that factory, because that food additive is going to be marketed worldwide and has already had regulatory approval in the European Union. So you talked about, for example, changing perhaps some of the subsidies for agriculture, so we could perhaps incentivise farmers to use this safe food additive to reduce methane rather than some of the more complex methods that are being currently considered. Okay, so the advert for DSM being over, I shall now open out to questions around the table, with Liz to be followed by Ross.
Thank you, and good morning for, as the convener said, a very thought-provoking presentation. You mentioned at the start that there are obviously two crises that we're dealing with, namely the biodiversity one and the climate change, and of course we've now got a third crisis, and that is what's happening in Ukraine. And notwithstanding the absolutely horrific scenes that we see hour by hour on our television screens, this crisis is going to have the effect of making us look very long and hard at the energy mix that we have longer term. So can I just ask you on that point, how significant do you think that is in terms of governments having to apply a slightly more practical approach to this, rather than what we'd all like to do is drive to net zero, but obviously, as Germany has found out very quickly, that is not going to be quite so easily accessible in the timescale that we originally thought because of the practicalities of this. Do you think that's very significant?
I do. I think there's two aspects to it. I think one, it does give you a really strong incentive to create that energy security for yourself. And a lot of that's going to come from renewables. There's no doubt about it, simply because Scotland has such a huge supply of them. But yeah, you know, the impacts we're feeling now, and we're probably going to see potentially get worse over the next year or two. So that does, you know, in my mind, then your priority starts to come into like making sure that, you know, you're going to have a challenging situation around fuel poverty, for example, and you might have to take measures that address that. And some of those might be, as you say, pragmatic and recognise that we can't change all the systems overnight. I would love it if everybody had a renewable heating system and solar panels on their property, but we can't do that overnight. Interestingly, we could probably accelerate some of these things. You know, the solar panel area, obviously, the feed-in tariff scheme that's mentioned in this report was withdrawn a few years ago. And so then we've had a massive drop-off in solar panel installations. It only really makes sense if you're building a new house or having a new roof rather than just a retrofit. So there may be measures that you can do there to really accelerate, you know, on an emergency basis, so some higher take-up. But I do think you're going to have two things. You're going to have to really push the renewable energy, realising that it could take years before you make a real difference. But obviously, you're going to have to take some measures, difficult measures, in the short term to address things like the sheer cost of heating and electricity, which is a real challenge.
Very much agree with that. I think there are issues not just for consumers, because there's no question that to change some of the systems within houses is going to be extremely expensive for the families involved, as in very expensive, way into the thousands if they're making that change. And that's a huge issue for an awful lot of families. But there's also an issue from the suppliers, or the producers, I should say, angle, whereby at the moment, because of what's happened in Ukraine, and likely to be quite long term, there is an incentive, unfortunately, for people to continue using some of the less effective energy systems that we've had on climate change, because that's the easiest way to ensure that we do have an energy mix. Do you foresee that that's a problem in terms of driving incentives on the renewable side?
It's difficult to answer because I don't know what the measures would be, but I think you can, you know, to use that phrase, I think you can parallel track in a way, because you might have measures that are about just stability to help people get through the current situation, and that getting through that current situation with reference to heat systems means maintaining your current heat system in an affordable way which doesn't damage your health. But at the same time, you could have really up the ante, if you like, on the renewables and the investment going forward for the long term. Kind of do both of those things as best you can at the same time. I think people, I mean, being somebody who wants, who's very invested in the green agenda, if you like, it's disheartening for me to think that we might have to take measures that are kind of not going to be pushing completely all the renewable energy. You know, it might be a case of stabilisation of what's there already. But at the end of the day, that's, I think, is going to have to happen. The price of energy affects everything. So we haven't made that transition yet to a renewable, completely renewable energy system. So we're subject to all these things and we have to react. So. Does that answer your question?
Yes, it does. I think this is a really serious issue, and I'm not sure certainly not an answer just now, but I think it's going to be a long-term problem that, you know, there'll be an emphasis to use existing supplies of energy, which are not particularly environmentally friendly, for quite some time. And, you know, as I say, European countries have already found that this is a bit of an issue because of the Ukraine crisis. Can I just ask about another aspect of your work, particularly when it comes to the research? You were talking about landfill tax being a relatively good tax in the term that it's done what it was asked to do, and it was, you know, seen to be effective and had the public on board. Is it the case that when it comes to, I think, what economists would call marginal cost pricing, in other words, you can see the extra cost of another one person using that service. Is it the case, do you think, that marginal cost pricing is more effective in getting the public to adhere to the behaviour change that they want than compared with something like average cost pricing, which tends to, I think you cited the example of the John Muir Trust, and I should declare an interim member of the John Muir Trust, where you cited an important part about a sort of cross-subsidisation, which has its merit in totality, but it doesn't necessarily work in terms of those people who are, you know, having to pay the subsidy across to others. Is marginal cost pricing a better aspect to the fiscal levers that you think we need to apply?
It could be. I mean, I always find it hard to grasp marginal cost pricing without a clear example of where it's applied, because it can look very different in different areas. But I think it will. It could be I suppose I've not got a clear answer on it, but I think it could be a very useful tool, and particularly in areas where there's a kind of trigger point where just like a slight change might tip something the way you want it, and you don't have to put much effort, and it doesn't have a big negative impact. So I think from that perspective, it could work. But I suppose I would kind of cover myself by saying it can really depends on the example of where you're applying it and what the weather impact.
Just in terms of the dilemma, I think is what you mentioned earlier, is that to get people to respond well, nobody likes paying taxes, but to respond as well as they can, it's about a behaviour change aspect, and people are more likely to come with you if they understand why the tax is necessary, but secondly, what is their role? You know, how much extra are they going to be taxed on the margin And that's what I'm asking, if that's a better means of ensuring that people come with you, because we do need cultural change. And that, I sat on the Environment Committee when this issue was being discussed a couple of years ago, and that was very much our view at the time, that you're not going to make much progress unless you get public buy-in to this.
Yeah, I think that is essential. There has to be understanding and fair transparency and discussion about these things, and that's challenging and again takes time, which again comes back to kind of repurposing things, because if you already have a whole lot of stakeholders involved in something that is, a taxation measure, and you say to them, we're going to tweak this, it's a lot easier than starting afresh with something new. You've already engaged with them, you've probably got resources, technical and civil service that already work in that area. So I think that is true. And I think really, it's a very good point about the engagement. I mean, obviously, people readily accepted, or I think they readily accepted something like the plastic, the single-use carry bag charge, and they understand it. And they readily accepted the price increase, because the other thing about the marginal issue around behavioural change is it can change. People get used to something, and then you need to increase it, and so you need to have that flexibility. But I do think that is important. And all the things that are mentioned here would all require quite a lot of engagement going forward. It is a massive exercise, but it has to be done. Otherwise, you're not going to bring people with you.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Ross, to be followed by Douglas.
And thank you, Callum, for the presentation. It was really interesting. It was interesting in particular in some of the comments you made around procurement and the potential for positive reform there. And you referenced the agreement, the Bute House agreement, that underpins what the government's currently doing. So what the Bute House agreement commits to in terms of conditionality around procurement for net zero purposes is we're going to consult on, for businesses who are receiving a grant alone or equity funding of more than £500,000, and for major contracts, a condition for all of that for them to reduce scope 1 and 2 greenhouse gas emissions at a level consistent with the 2045 targets, a requirement that they publish a carbon management plan, and that they submit a copy of that plan to whichever government body is providing them with that funding. As one of the folk who wrote that particular section of the agreement, I'm hoping, given your comments earlier, you can tell me that perhaps there's areas that we've missed, there's areas that we could build upon here. If you're one of the people that were consulting on this particular condition that we might put on public procurement, what more can we do to make this more effective? Because at the moment, it's essentially just a commitment to say that they will reduce their emissions and that they provide us with a plan on how they're going to do that. Is there more that we could be asking for there?
I think the challenge is... is looking at how all that system would work. I think it's a good approach. The challenge is, if you ask any organisation to produce a carbon plan, they'll all produce something completely different, and they will probably get advice from different consultants with different views. So I think anything you can do to make it as easy as possible, I would envisage, and this is just my personal view, but I think it's based on pragmatism, that when you first start this out, it's going to be quite simple. So you might want to keep it quite simple, referencing the fact that the staff involved in assessing this and also the businesses are starting a journey, and it's going to get more and more mainstream as time goes on. But in that initial phase, you're going to have people looking at and assessing these carbon plans and assessing whether what the people that are applying for the grants are telling you the truth in terms of the targets and what looks realistic. And I don't think that should be underestimated in terms of the resource, but also the hand-holding for the businesses and the people that get grants. That is going to be really important. And it's going to be really important for the government as well. The more you probably spend on hand-holding, the more you'll recover and save time in terms of assessing these plans and making sure they're good ones, because you'll have already helped the business or the organisation get themselves into the right place. So I think my general comment would be thinking about that, trying to get the right resources and support in place, and trying to make it it's really challenging, but as simple as possible in the first stages. I mean, my view is that what you might be asking now, in 5 years' time, it will be much more developed. But at this point, you might have to keep it relatively simple, and that may be challenging for kind of green people who really want to see it progressing. But it's going to be challenging to ask these questions from businesses and make sure they've got the answers. So I don't know if that answers your your question in any way.
No, that was really useful. I might, in a separate capacity, come back to you later on when the formal consultation on that starts to ask you to put that in writing. One of the other points that you made in the report that I was quite taken by was the comment that, particularly given the urgency of the climate emergency, that reform of existing levers of taxation is perhaps more attractive than the creation of new ones. So I'm interested in your thoughts on potential for reform in a couple of areas. And you may not have seen this last week. The Fraser Valander Institute Commission published a report that was commissioned by the government on the small business bonus scheme and its relative effectiveness. I'm interested in if you have any particular views on how mechanisms like the business bonus scheme could be reformed, or perhaps in other areas, given where we do have more latitude for reform, something like council tax, so that there is the potential for significant reform or even replacement of the council tax in this session, or at least starting in this session, because it's complex and it would take a while to implement. Do you have any particular thoughts on the direction of travel, either in reforming something like the business bonus scheme, economic incentives like that, or local taxation like the council tax?
I have to hold my hand up and say, within this work, I didn't really look at council tax and what might come. But what I am aware of is that in the past, when we've looked at, or the research has been, when you've looked at tweaking council tax for something like a better performing house, for example, in terms of renewable energy or whatever, I don't know if it's a strong enough incentive. I mean, it might look good, you're going to pay less tax, but does it really change behaviour? I would question that. And I'm not familiar with the small business bonus scheme, so I can't comment on that. But I would say, from a general perspective, I haven't read the Fraser Allender report, but from a general perspective, I think what you mentioned would apply. What we just discussed on larger funding, eventually you would want that $500,000 to be smaller and smaller, to the point where it's just all the money going out the door has to almost, I hate to use the term, tick a box, but it has to show that it's aligned with all the targets in 2045 and any biodiversity targets that come forward. So I think the same applies to that. I suppose in terms of priority, you would look where's the biggest expenditure and where's likely to be the biggest benefit, coming back to the earlier point about marginal cost. So you would choose which schemes to intervene in first to bring in that kind of tick box exercise. But business rates is a different thing. So there already are quite a few incentives in business rates. So there are things for renewable energy. There are, for example, you get a reduction if you've got a deposit return machine and things like that. So I think, you know, bearing in mind what I said about the John Muir Trust initial proposal, there's probably more, you might get more responsiveness from the business rates side. But I have to say, one of the people, I hesitate to say this because it's a negative phrase, but one of the people that I spoke to in the study to get information said business rates is a dying tax because of all the changes that are happening in society as a whole. But I still think that business rates offer the opportunity to have a more kind of clear incentive, and it's likely, possibly, this is my personal opinion, to be more taken up than a household or council tax type thing. So I haven't really answered the question properly there, but I hope that's...
No, that was useful. And to be fair, the Small Business Bonus Scheme report that only came out last week, and it came out quite quietly, so I wasn't necessarily expecting you to have noticed it. Just one final question. You were relatively critical, in a way that I would agree with, of the forestry grant scheme, in that it focuses on economic benefit that comes from commercial forestry, so essentially, you know, monoculture, Sitka spruce, etc., that certainly isn't contributing towards restoration of biodiversity, tackling the nature emergency. What kind of reform would you be looking at in an area like forestry grants? What would look like a successful version of that scheme if we're taking this from if the overarching objectives are tackling the climate and nature emergencies?
I think from a very simple perspective, it would be the proportion of the forestry that was funded from public, a significant proportion of it would be native species planting, from a simple perspective. There is a lot more complexity within that, you know, in terms of, you know, riparian woodlands and woodland planting around rivers, etc., that we've lost. And so there's a lot of subtlety there, which I think where the Costa Rica ecosystem service payments come in, we probably want to look at, you know, if you have planted Sitka spruce, there's a way of, you know, if that is going to be a commercial crop, there are things you can do around that to get more benefit out of it. So I think that's where some of the subtleties of the subsidies are at. But again, it's quite challenging to put a lot of those complexities into a scheme. So it has to be maintained really simple. But I think the key measure would be if you just looked at the amount of native trees planted, if you were looking for a key indicator, that would be the simplest one. So that hectareage, whether it's 18,000 hectares a year, if you increase that to half of it being native planting, then you realise you're doing the right thing. But then you might want to include in there some other measure as well, if you, that was looking at where you have planted commercial forestry, what measures have you put in there to mitigate some of the damage. So keeping it simple, that's what I would look for.
Excellent. Thanks very much. That's all from me at the moment, Convener.
Okay, thank you. Douglas, followed by John.
Thanks, Convener, and thank you, Callum, for the presentation this morning. Really, really enjoyed it. One of the concerns I have around the environmental fiscal measures is a potential disproportionate effect on some of our rural communities. You know, I'm thinking, you know, private transport, there's a greater reliance on, and even public transport, it's probably got a larger carbon footprint than maybe somewhere in the central belt. I'm thinking things like ferries, for example, are mainly all diesel. Some of the high-speed trains that we depend on out with the central belt are, you know, diesel as well, and, you know, air as well for some of our island communities. So how do we make sure that anything we introduce doesn't hit them disproportionately?
I think that comes back to one of the principles that I put in the sort of my start of a 10 strategic approach is something's got to be proportionate. But I also think within that you need to look at the winners and losers. And if you have got some losers, how can you sort of mitigate that impact? But I think anything that needs to be designed, going back to that engagement piece, needs to consider not just people living in the central belt, but rural communities, and the fact that they're more likely to be on oil heating, for example. They're more likely to have properties that perhaps need more insulation, or more importantly, more bespoke solutions. We're very good at rolling out programs that are very kind of basic in design, just like loft insulation and cavity wall. But then when you come to hard to treat houses, it's a completely different situation, and you probably need some more technical skills and something that's, which governments are not used to in terms of like a very simple program to roll out, but actually it might be quite challenging. So I think thinking about those things, and obviously the impact, if it's about transport, how is that impact going to translate in rural communities, and can there be some compensating mechanisms? I mean, one of the things I suppose in there that I've mentioned is in relation to electrification of transport, you might want to look at how you can help rural communities with that electrification process, which might mean more fast chargers on, you know, in rural roads, which is what's been done in Norway, so that you can get, if you want people onto electric cars because they're cheaper than the rising fuel prices we have, one of the barriers is range, and if you can do those measures. So it might be a mixture of design engagement around the fiscal measures that you're doing and thinking about some of the mitigations and the proportionality, and then maybe some other factors that are not fiscal measures at all but actually will help. So I think that's the way I would look at it from the research that I've done.
Okay, thank you for that, because I guess as we have to make sure that they are not, as you say, disproportionately impacted. Other thing I want to pick up on is you mentioned energy from waste, and maybe it wasn't in such a good place as it was previously thought. Would that be correct in what you were saying there? And I'm just trying to think, if that is the case, should you know, is there a review taking place on energy from waste, or should there be now a moratorium put in place until we've evaluated it more?
My understanding is there is a commitment to a review by the Scottish Government. I can't remember whether that's part of the partnership agreement between the SNP and the Greens, or whether it's within the the climate change plan. So sorry, I can't remember where that's stated. But there is a review, and yes, what's happened over time, I mean, we have within the EU and within the UK, we had a policy which was landfill is the worst in terms of climate change emissions because of the methane release from things rotting in landfill, and energy from waste was the better solution, although obviously we really want recycling and reuse. But that's changed because of the composition of the waste. So as we've got better, I suppose you could say we should have anticipated this 10 years ago, but as we've got better at pulling out waste material, particularly food and paper and card, which are the materials that rot in the landfill, the methane emissions from the landfill are dropping, whereas what you're ending up with energy from waste is a lot of fossil fuel-based energy from all the plastics that are being burnt. So that's where the change is happening. So effectively, you've got a report from Zero Waste Scotland that has highlighted that energy from waste is actually now, you know, quite high carbon technology, and putting it on the electricity grid is one of the higher carbon technologies as well. So that is an issue. I suppose in terms of what you do about it, I think you have to take a measured approach and plan, because there's a lot of investment required and everything. But I think even just highlighting now, as is happening in the European Union, that people are aware of it and they realise they're going to have to take some action. The industry is starting to see that this energy from waste might, you know, have a limited time horizon, given the situation.
I guess it would be better if we managed to get all the plastics out of that, and then to, you know, if we met our recycling targets, then that would make energy from waste better for the environment.
I would agree with that. Obviously, the more you get out, the less feedstock there is for the energy from waste industry. So that's an issue. And also the other thing is that from energy from waste, the best performance tends to be from heat-only plants rather than generating electricity, because conversion to electricity reduces the efficiency. So the carbon, overall carbon impact rises. So you would also want to look at not only the feedstock going into energy from waste plants, but you want to look at the technology and what that plant was doing. If it's distributing to a district heating network, then it's got generally a far better profile from carbon emissions than it would be if it was generating electricity only. So,
right. Thank you very much for that. Other question I had was around TVL, but in your report you call it environment tourism tax. Now, I've been a councillor for the last 5 years, and you know, it's been a difficult sell to many in the hospitality industry to, you know, when we mentioned TVL. But you know, one of the ways around that is that, you know, all money raised would be reinvested back into tourism to try and grow the industry. But this seems to be a sort of a change to that, where it's changed from a carrot into a stick. Would that be fair?
I don't think so. I think it's still a carrot, or it's what I would call a hypothecated tax. So I suppose what I'm suggesting is, if you want it to be accepted by visitors and you want it to be accepted by locals, the money has to be reinvested locally. And the two examples I gave in there are where they've really focused on the environmental aspect. So you can get that reinvestment locally, but it might be reinvestment that helps, you know, some of the tourist attractions reduce their emissions, or helps restore some of the damage to the countryside, or enhance the biodiversity for the tourists or whatever. So trying to focus on an environmental benefit seems to work really well in the Balearic Islands and Barcelona, where the kind of the main focus is on that. I think definitions, you know, what is an environment? What do you mean by that? It can mean anything from improving the road infrastructure to planting trees. So I think I make the point that if you are going to reinvest it, I think it needs to be clear what it is. And when those schemes were started that I referenced, there's quite a broad definition, but now we could probably be very specific about we're going to invest it here. And I think that could potentially get buy-in. But I do make the point that we have very high VAT here, the higher VAT charges, which could make something like that not viable. So I think that really needs to be considered. You know, it could severely impact the tourism industry as well. So there are negative impacts to it. Does that answer?
Yes, no. Thank you very much. And thanks, Convener.
Okay, thanks, Douglas. And Douglas touched on ferries. And I should say, apart from ferries being designed to be hybrid, the smaller ferries are now being designed so that, because a ferry can last upwards of 25 years, to be retrofitted. So, for example, you know, they may be fitted with hybrid power systems now, but in 5 years they could switch to electric, or 10 years hydrogen or whatever. So that's now the kind of design that's been built into the design of these ferries. Not just buses and cars and trains that we have to make more environmentally friendly. Okay, John, to be followed by Michelle.
Thanks very much, Convener, and thanks for the input so far. It's been really interesting. One of your conclusions seemed to be that we could do with an overarching simplified carbon tax, if I've got the phrase correct. And I just wondered if you could maybe explain that to me. I mean, you've already said it would have to be at UK level, but I suppose we're interested in that as well, and we can maybe encourage the UK government to do certain things. So, I mean, I'm just wondering, is that like you just say, well, it's VAT on everything, but it's 5% here, 10% here, 20% over here. Is that the idea of a carbon tax?
Yeah, I think the idea is to create the transparency. So, you know, you might have, however it's kind of administered, you might have something where the carbon tax is X percent on, say, diesel or petrol, and then it's X percent on heating oil or whatever, depending on what the actual carbon impact is. But it's not as simple as that, because it could be very... I think everyone thinks carbon tax is a silver bullet because it provides a transparency to businesses and you and I to see, oh, I'm getting charged this much. And it could be similar to VAT. You know, you look at your receipt and you've got a carbon tax and you've got VAT or anything, other charges. But it's likely to have quite a detrimental impact on low income. So you have to be really careful about that. I think the general view from the literature out there is, you know, you'd have to put in place some mitigations for that carbon tax, because you might find that potentially people, for example, on heating oil, suddenly find they've got a much higher charge on their heating, and affecting rural communities or those that are in properties where they don't have a lot of income. So you do have to be careful. It's not the silver bullet. It is the one tax to rule them all in some ways, but it would have to have some mitigations as well. But you could see it applied in different rates, and that's the whole point of it, I suppose. You would look at a flight and you would see a charge and you would go, oh my gosh, that's quite high, but that's because the impact of that flight is much higher than, say, taking a train.
Yeah, so to your point, I think it's page 37 of your report where you say low-income households will spend a higher percentage of their income on high emission activities. So that is a kind of challenge. So, I mean, would landfill tax then, we just rename it as carbon tax and single-use bags, and all, would we call them all carbon tax? Would that be the idea?
Well, I mean, that's one approach you could take, is you could start to change the names of things, and if you were trying to make them more consistent, but you might find that there are other reasons. So, for example, you might put... you could try and get the consistency in the carbon... For example, in the carbon tax, even on a single-use carrier bag charge, you could try and do the same. But that doesn't mean to say they would all end up being priced in carbon, because there are other factors to consider in that mix. So you might say, well, the landfill tax, there's carbon, but we've also got to consider the impacts on local communities and some other things. So you might actually, the charge might be much higher than the carbon charge alone. And similarly, you might look at the single-use carrier bag charge, or say if you introduce a charge on coffee cups, and you might say, well, the carbon charge should be really 5 pence, but actually that's not going to make anyone change behaviour, so actually we need to change it to 20 pence. So it's going to be something that could create more consistency, but it doesn't mean to say that everything's going to be priced exactly the same, because there will be other factors. That would be my personal view.
Okay, and that kind of leads me on, because you said they're changing behaviour, and that... I think it was on your point. I was looking at the page 23, where you've got single-use carrier bags and Scottish landfill tax both there. And I think I'm right in suggesting that you're saying that because the individual, myself or whoever, is paying 5p or 10p for a bag, that directly changes my behaviour. Scottish landfill tax, though, doesn't quite work that way, does it? Because I don't pay for the damage I'm doing. Vaguely, the council has to pay a bit more. they might change my council tax, but it doesn't kind of impact on me at all.
Yes, and that is a challenge. And I have suggested some minor things that we can do in here. I think, again, I would come back to the point about a carbon tax versus emissions trading schemes, because emissions trading schemes are firmly in the background. You know, you wouldn't know what a business is paying in terms of allowances. You would just see their price, so that wouldn't be transparent. What I have suggested in the report is, related to waste, is what we have is producer responsibility schemes, which where businesses are made responsible for the product or the waste at the end of its life, generally. And so if you somebody that's got, for example, a waste electronic equipment, like a computer, if you make that computer, then you have to help at the end of its life with the recycling or the capture of that material. What I'm suggesting in here is the way to engage the public, because they aren't aware of that scheme in the background, is if we have more deposits on things. So, you know, the obvious example is small waste electronic equipment, which, you know, electric toothbrush, which often just ends up in landfill because people don't know what to do with it. They're not going to drive to a recycling centre to place it in a container like they would a washing machine. So maybe that's an area where you have a deposit, so people are incentivised, oh, I'll take this back and I'll get my £2 back or my £5 back. So it's a deposit rather than an extra charge, and that would certainly work on batteries, which is being discussed at European level, because we're not collecting all the batteries that we should. But if consumers saw that deposit, they would value, it's creating a value for them like it is on drinks containers, suddenly that whole changes the whole behaviour. So I think that's the way of bringing those things to engage businesses and people into the foreground. There's probably other ways, but that's a simple one that we could do.
No, I mean, I think you're right. I mean, I think lack of information, but I don't know where to put my old electric razor or whatever it is. Frankly, some of the recycling sites in Glasgow, they've deteriorated. There used to be somewhere for electrical items. Now I can't find it, that kind of thing. Another issue you've raised is you seem to be quite keen on hypothecation, that the money goes, you know, and I get it for the tourist tax, as Douglas Lumsden was asking. But, I mean, with the single-use carrier bag, in a sense, it doesn't matter where the money goes. The point is that I don't want to spend 5p. And, of course, well, some of the businesses, I think most of them are giving it to charity, and I don't know who the charities are, but anyway. So, you know, is it really important? Or, I mean, if we can make money off a carrier bag or returning cups or whatever it is and put it into the NHS, is that not equally good?
I would say you could do that, and then obviously there was a lot of discussion at the time the single-use carrier bag charge came in, and maybe if there's a similar charge on coffee cups, it will be the same. But I think the simplicity of doing it without getting involved. So if you say you went to the single-use plastic single-use carrier bags, the money goes back to the retailer, and as you say, they're encouraged to put the money to charity. But that's nice and simple, and then the government doesn't really, apart from policing the scheme, doesn't have to really get involved. I was actually working for a local authority the first time we looked at single-use carrier bag charges, and the government was trying to find a way to get the money back into the public exchequer, if you like, and it was so complex, and eventually they gave up. And so I think there's a place for things like that, but there's also a place for just saying, let the retailer keep the money. We'll encourage them to do the right thing. But we're trying to get the behaviour change. That's the key thing. And so does it matter? You know, it might take you 5 years longer to get the charge in where you get a bit of revenue, whereas you could get it in, you know, really quickly. So I think there's a kind of offset. And in some ways, the minimum prices is an easy thing to do. And retailers are less going to likely, or businesses are going to complain less if they're not having to give the Scottish Government money, and they just keep it themselves, and sometimes it's cost for them, so it makes sense. Does that answer your question? Sorry.
No, that's fine. I mean, there's just so much in this that, I mean, we could all be here asking questions for an hour, which presumably the convener doesn't want. Because another biggie that I think we haven't really looked at too much this morning, I mean, you've talked about tax being neutral, and your ideas is that, you know, we maybe could take a bit off income tax or something and put it on somewhere else, or council tax and waste and so on. But a big one, and you do mention this in your report, is fuel duty and the fact that so much of our petrol costs when we fill up our cars does go to the government. So can you say a little more about where you think we can go with that? Because if we're giving all these incentives to electric cars and they don't pay so much road tax and they don't pay this and don't pay that, and I think you're even suggesting they should get cheaper parking and things, you know, how do we compensate for that? What's going to happen?
I think that's a big issue that for the UK government, because the I've forgotten the actual numbers, but you know, we're talking billions of revenue that would be lost. So then the question is what happens in that. Now, the obvious thing, I suppose, is that they could just, once everybody's got electric cars, start taxing in terms of the kind of your annual tax that you pay duty on the car. They could just increase that, whereas at the moment it's very, very cheap, obviously, for electric cars. But in terms of the lost fuel revenue, I mean, the consensus has been that would get replaced with road pricing. And if you'd asked me a few years ago, I would have thought, I just can't see that happening because it's so complex. But technology's moved on. And, you know, you're seeing what's happening in London with them sort of pioneering some of the changes in terms of charging and in the congestion zone in London. And I think if, you know, London manages to do these things and it becomes more electronic and everything, then you could see road pricing coming forward. So I would say, you know, if I was the UK government, I'd be sitting there, I'm going to gradually lose billions of pounds. I need to do something. Road pricing looks the most obvious to me from the research work that I've done. And I know it's not popular and there's lots of issues around it, but, you know, just looking at it pragmatically, it looks like the most likely option.
Okay, I could ask more, but I think I'll leave it at that. Thank you, Convener.
I mean, Australia's had that for some 20 years. You drive along a motorway and you get an electric chip in your car. You don't have to stop at any toll booths or anything. You drive along and as you pass these every 5 kilometres, whatever it happens to be, you know, it's almost like being in a taxi and the kind of meter ticks over. So they've been doing that for, if they've been doing that for 20 years, there's no reason why it can't be done here. Although, as you said, I don't think it will be exactly very popular and it would have to be met with reductions probably in other motor-related tax. I mean, I think one of the things, of course, about road tax is it's not all spent on the roads, and I think that's, it just goes into general taxation. Okay, Michelle?
Yep, sorry, I just wanted to quote something. I mean, I think you've done a great job in your report, and particularly restricting it to only 90 pages, such as the complexity of the area. And, of course, we've got this backdrop, which I also looked at the UK Parliament report from the Public Accounts Committee, and they make clear, you know, we've got a plan, the UK government has a plan without answering the key questions of how it will fund transition to net zero, including how it will deliver policy on replace income from taxes such as fuel duty, or even a general direction of travel on levies and taxation, which kind of really nails it. So I suppose the question then, when I went and read your report, the principles you set out, a few could disagree with them. But it immediately struck me that there must be areas where if you adhere to one principle, you're actually going to be moving against another principle. Are there any particular areas that you would want to bring out that's not been brought out thus far? Some of the examples you've already given, and it is around complexity, but I think it'd be useful to have some more examples of that, because I wouldn't in any way underestimate the complexity of what we've got to try and do.
Yeah, I mean, it's a challenge. I mean, I did say kind of coming to a strategic approach in this is really a starter for 10 using university challenge language. And it is true. I mean, the principles there are meant to be balanced. It is not there isn't a scientific answer. And I think some of the questions from the committee have drawn that out. What about rural properties? What about ferries? What about, you know, so you could take a kind of scientific approach to the principles, but at the end of the day, it's about finding the right balance for something. So I think, I mean, the one thing I would say is, I do think that the overall whole government approach is so important going forward, and a lot of the perhaps if that goes forward. You know, in terms of the whole government applying the same principles for biodiversity and climate change and all the money it spends, you're less likely to get conflicts in some of these principles because everything's going in the right direction. The other thing I would probably pull out apart from the route mapped, which I mentioned, is the holistic policy package. So it's really important, and I think, again, it's come up in terms of heating and the fiscal measures often in an area, especially where the Scottish Government doesn't have full control, are only really one piece of the jigsaw. And it's kind of trying to look at that wider thing. And so you might look at a fiscal measure and you might go, well, actually, we would be just better just banning that. often governments don't like to ban things because it's not very popular. But it may be that you go, well, actually, a fiscal measure here might not work. So maybe we actually have to look at a whole package of other support, or do a fiscal measure with a whole lot of other support. So I think that's the other thing that I would draw out. Because I've not worked, this is a starter for 10, I've not worked through to see where there might be some obvious conflicts. I'm hoping there won't be, but I'm sure they will come up when there'll be particular niche interests or things that haven't been considered when you look at any particular area of the Scottish Parliament's competence.
So, I suppose following on from that then, obviously you've looked at other countries and you've put them in your report and so on, but as you again highlight, part of the complexity is around the process of fiscal transfers, which is particularly complex for the Scottish Parliament. So within your thinking, did you consider other states where there's a similar model of fiscal transfers?
I didn't get an opportunity within this research to do that. I mean, I obviously saw some of the measures, individual measures that we're doing in each area, but I didn't have a overall approach to look at which country's doing a transfer better than others. That's something maybe that is definitely worth looking at. I think what did come up, I suppose, is in the general perspective about the proportion of resource tax, which is an environmental taxation, and the taxation bracket rather than the grants and subsidies bracket is only 6 to 7%, and for the EU 27. And when you look at that graph, you can see it's actually maybe not going in the right direction even. So you could say no one's yet showing a sign of good transition, but I didn't look at it specifically, so I may have missed something. So that's maybe something for the future, maybe the Parliament wants to consider.
Okay. I could ask a multitude of questions like everyone else, but we would genuinely be here all day. Thank you very much. Thanks, Convener.
Oh, you could ask another one if you like.
Okay, right. Well, since I've been invited, you do allude to some of the potential limitations introduced by the UK Internal Market Act and the Subsidy Control Bill. Obviously, this is still, it's been refused an LCM by the Scottish Parliament, and the Economy Committee, which I'm also on, has written quite stringently about it. Are there any other particular areas you'd want to bring out here? Because it's the timing element, as initiatives may be attempted to be introduced by the Scottish Government. They then, as you point out, may fall foul of the Subsidy Control Bill when actually they're trying to do the right thing for the right reasons within a very restricted framework. And in your report, you make commentary about it, but you don't choose to give specific examples. Are there any examples that you would like to bring out here?
I suppose in my mind, yes, there's probably a couple I would point out. I'm not saying they're the largest or most significant, but I was thinking about the common frameworks that are developing, and I think that around waste-related things that we've obviously discussed a bit today, maybe I'm being hopeful, but I think there's always been quite a strong framework of competence for the Scottish Parliament, Scottish Government around waste and circular economy. And so I think there's potential in those common agreements for still to have some leeway. That's why I make the comment that energy from waste, if you bring in an energy from waste tax of some kind, then it might be through that mechanism if other countries haven't already done it in the UK. There's two other comments I'd make. One is I'm concerned about what it means for minimum prices, because I think we've shown with the single-use carrier charge that minimum prices can be a really useful little tool to change behaviour in particular areas, and I would like to see the Scottish Parliament having that in its toolbox for a number of things, and that probably extends to, you know, putting deposits as well, as I mentioned, like deposits on particular waste streams that we want to address in a different way. And looking at it in this early stage, it looks like that would be a problem. So might lose that ability, which would be a shame. And then the third thing I would say is on the subsidies bill. When I looked at that, my concern was about agricultural subsidies, so so significant to the Scottish economy. And actually, when I read the bill, and I'm not a lawyer, it didn't look very focused on that. It looked more focused on, and I may be completely wrong, and it may change, looked more focused on about funding businesses through state aid, etc. So, you know, in terms of manufacturing and other businesses rather than agriculture. So I was kind of hopeful that that aligned with the fact that in England they are moving in the same direction as some of the things I've mentioned about where I think agricultural subsidies need to go. I'm hoping that there'll be no barriers to the changes in the agricultural subsidies for Scotland Parliament. So those are the minimum prices, the agricultural subsidies, and I've actually forgotten what I said first. Sorry. Those are the three things that sprung into my mind. But they're just, as I went through this, it's not that they've got particular significance, but those are the points that came into my head.
And for the record, Convener, can I just point out that the Scottish Government is recommending the refusal of an LCM rather than it yet being passed. Thank you very much.
Thank you for that, Michelle. And that's concluded questions from the committee. But just two wee things for me. One of my great concerns is biodiversity. So, for example, I read only in the last couple of weeks in The Economist that that excluding our seas, 96% of the biomass of all vertebrate creatures on Earth is either human or the livestock that we raise to feed us. So, for example, 70% of all bird life on the planet is poultry. So you touched on, for example, some of the measures that have been done in Sweden with regard to the lynx, and I know that the Iberian lynx, which was on the verge of extinction, there's a lot of work being done there to try and restore it. But what more can we do in terms of biodiversity? Because you spoke about, for example, in tree plantations, you know, perhaps up to half being native woodland. And we have done a lot in Scotland, and since the First World War, when tree cover was down to 2%, we're up now back to about 17-18%. Not quite Japan, which is 73% and has been over the centuries. They've never denuded their forests at all. But what more can we do to try and restore the biodiversity, which has halved worldwide since the 1970s?
I think the agricultural subsidies are important here in getting it right. Obviously, we are a very forest-degraded country to what was originally there. So getting back the native forestry, when you plant a native forest, it doesn't create magically an ecosystem, but then it comes through time. So I think having that more of a mosaic of our landscape where there's more of that native forestry is going to be really important. So any incentives that we can do to do that, whether they be through the agricultural forestry payment system or even encouraging investment and offsets and that under the carbon, there's the Woodland Carbon Code. And I think that's a really good mechanism that provides some certainty about what climate change benefit you're getting. For businesses that want to invest in offsets and things, but it's a good way of, with some safeguards, of getting more forestry. So I think that more of native forestry is going to be key. I suppose the other area I touched on was persecution of animals, and I think we need to turn, you know, if we can do something in fiscal measures that changes that concept that many people have, particularly in agriculture where things are viewed as pests, if we can turn that around so that some of that wildlife is seen as positive because there's a payment involved, then I think that's important, and that's why I included it, because obviously we're seeing some fantastic reintroductions in terms of the sea eagle, the red kite and the beaver, but then we've got some huge challenges of persecution of those because of some of the damage they do, and it would be good to find a way of turning that round in our own behaviour and thinking, well, it's a positive thing, I get paid for them being here. So those are the two things that come into mind. I suppose one thing that didn't come out too strongly was peatland. So obviously we have still a huge peatland resource, and there's a peatland code as well. And I think trying to encourage that in some way, providing a framework, it may not be a fiscal measure, it may just be providing a framework for investment. And I think it's going to be important as well to maintain that biodiversity. So those are the things. That's all terrestrial. So I didn't go into detail in marine. Obviously, I mentioned some of the fishery thing payments, but I didn't go into the marine area. So that's in reference really to the terrestrial wildlife.
I'll stick to land. I mean, we've got no take zone, and Scotland's only no take zone among constituency, so I think there's a lot more we can do on that. But in terms of land, I mean, what you've said basically is, would be great for, you know, helping to extend the number of squirrels and pine martens we've got, and birds, etc. But ultimately, you know, what about reintroducing apex predators? You know, I mean, obviously wolves died out in Scotland in the 17th, 18th century. Bears probably 1,000 years earlier. Minnesota's reintroduced wolves, which of course was ferociously opposed for understandable reasons by farmers and people who brought up on Little Red Riding Hood, etc., who thought the wolves would have a severe impact on human populations, which they don't. Are these things, do you think, going to be palatable in the decades ahead, do you think? I don't think perhaps we're ready for them quite yet, but are these things that you see? I mean, there was the red deer population in Scotland is now so high because of the lack of predation, that there's an argument there for introducing a predator that would perhaps reduce the numbers to avoid culling and indeed the destruction of the trees that we've just been talking about.
I mean, I can comment, and obviously it's not really a fiscal measure, but I can say that, I mean, the all likelihood from my experience is that, yes, it would be beneficial to get those predators. I think they will come. I think probably the first, I think maybe members of the committee may know as well that probably the most likely one is the lynx first. Obviously, there's a lot of controversy around wolves. I think some of the payment systems I've mentioned in here could certainly be beneficial. Obviously, lynx is not a main, although it's an apex predator, it's not a main predator of red deer, more a roe deer. But there's been a lot of groundwork done around the introduction of the lynx. So for me, looking at a personal perspective and as a rewilding enthusiast, I would say it looks the most likely of the apex predators to come first. And wolves are incredibly challenging for the reasons that you've said. But I think, you know, we've got some really good news from some of the innovative stuff that they're doing in America, and in buffer zones as well around areas where they've got apex predators like puma and lynx. What they've done is they've got the camera traps, and someone who's on a farm next door who gets a stray lynx, and then they get a payment from coming onto their land. But not only that, it comes back to what I was mentioning earlier about these supporting measures. They've all been supported in thinking differently about how they manage sheep and livestock, and bringing back in what was more traditional things like dogs that basically the apex predators are scared of. So that's a thing that's now developing as an industry on its own in America. Some of these large breeds of dogs that have traditionally guarded flocks, and getting support for farmers to have those as well as the camera traps. So there's a range of measures there, but I think the appetite is there now. I think more and more people are talking about it. And as this awareness of biodiversity and ecological restoration grows, I think there'll be more interest and maybe more support for things like that. So that's obviously my personal view. Some of the things not quite related to fiscal measures.
Well, fiscal measures have to be used to actually do this. It won't happen without significant fiscal measures. So I do think there's an important fiscal issue for us. If farmers are not incentivised, then they just won't do it. It's as simple as that. Okay, well, thank you very much, Cam, for your evidence. I think we all really appreciated your time this morning and your answering of questions and your excellent report. So with that, we shall now
call a 5-minute break, but I will say to you that your report will certainly inform the committee's approach to examining the finances of net zero and beyond, and we'll look at this again at a future meeting. So that's also concluded our public part of the meeting. So as well as having a break, we will go into private session at 11:30. Thank you.